In this Q&A video, we're going to answer the question, do I need to bond my incoming water pipe? Now this question relates to a video that Gary and Gordon made a while back on a handy little tool from Knipex called the Bix, and it's designed to cut through plastic pipes. Now obviously for electricians, this is intended to be used for plastic conduit, but it was originally designed for plumbers, and as I'm in the middle of refurbishing my kitchen, it made me think of this incoming water pipe here. Now as you can see, the original installer went to the trouble of connecting bonding conductors to the pipework under the sink here, which is pretty much in line with the practice at the time that the house was built. But is it necessary? Well, in the 18th edition of BS 7671, we find regulation 411.3.1.2. Under the heading Protective Ecopotential Bonding, we read, in each installation, main protective bonding conductors complying with Chapter 54 shall connect to the main earthing terminal extraneous conductive parts, including the following. 1. Water installation pipes, and so on and so forth. However, in that edition of the regs, we find this interesting addition. Metallic pipes entering the building having an insulating section at their point of entry need not be connected to the protective equipotential bonding. So the simple answer is no, this pipe does not require bonding. And when I replace this sink and adjust the pipework, I don't need to connect it back up again. But why not? Well, the answer lies in understanding why we bond. Let me get out of here and I'll explain why. To understand this, we need to go back to the transformer down the road that feeds my property. And what we're about to discuss is applicable to most homes in the UK. At the transformer, the star point, which is also the neutral connection, is connected to earth via an electrode or rod. That's the literal earth that we walk around on, by the way. This gives the transformer a reference for what 0 volts is and stops the output voltages going dangerously high. Now this earth connection is brought by various means to the property. In my case, it's via a TNCS supply. If it was a TNS supply, then what we're about to discuss in this video is still true, but there is an additional consideration for TNCS, which we'll discuss in a future video. Now, inside the house, all exposed conductive parts are connected to the main earth terminal, so that if a fault occurs inside a load and the metalwork becomes live, there's a nice low resistance earth path back that causes a high current to flow and blows the fuse or trips the circuit breaker. So far, so good. However, what if this piece of earth metal equipment is near a piece of metal pipe that enters the property via the actual earth? Now, this piece of pipe will have what's referred to as an earth potential, which remember is 0 volts, just like it was at the transformer. So when this fault occurs, a voltage can appear between the earth metalwork of the electrical equipment and the pipe. And that can be high enough to give a person touching both at the moment the fault occurs a severe enough shock to kill. How? Well, the answer lies in this very low resistance path back to the transformer. Even though it's very low in resistance, it does have a value, and if you have a resistance and you pass current through it, then there must be a voltage or potential difference between the two ends in order to push that current along. And because fault current is usually quite high, the voltage pushing it along can get quite high too. So between the metal bodywork of the electrical equipment and the center point of the transformer, there is a voltage. And if the center point of the transformer is at earth potential or 0 volts, then this pipe here must be at the same earth potential voltage of 0 volts. So whatever potential exists between the earth metalwork and the center point of the transformer must also exist between the earth metalwork and this pipe. Now at this point we could do a ton of maths to prove this, but I don't want to lose you just before the critical point. Maybe the team at eFIXX will let me do that another time. Now, if we connect a bonding cable from the main earthing terminal to this pipework, the voltage between the earth metalwork and the pipework will be reduced, as it takes a smaller voltage to push the fault current through the CPC of the circuit. And so the voltage between these two items will be lowered to a safe value, because the voltage on the pipe will actually be brought up to the same value as the main earth terminal. So that's one reason why we bond stuff. Now, for the crucial part. If we make this pipe into the property plastic, it no longer has a connection to the literal earth. Therefore, it no longer has an earth potential at 0 volts. Therefore, when the fault occurs, there's no voltage difference between the earth metalwork and the pipe. The pipe no longer has a potential of 0, it has no potential, which can be a little bit confusing. So let's think of it this way. The pipe is now the equivalent of the metal frame of a bed. It has no connection to the literal earth. It has no earth potential. It has no need to be bonded. You wouldn't bond that metal bed frame, so why would you bond the pipe? Now, at this point, you're probably thinking, but I'd bond it anyway, just in case a fault occurred and that pipework became live. Maybe you're thinking, what if a cable came to rest on a hot water pipe and the insulation melts and the pipework comes into contact with the line conductor? Well, you have to ask, why would that happen? Other regs would be applied that would keep cables adequately supported and at a suitable distance from the pipework. We can't apply bonding to allow for poor installation methods elsewhere. So there we go. One reason for bonding is to reduce the potential difference between the earth metalwork of an electrical installation and any metalwork that is connected to the literal earth that we walk around on. If an incoming pipe has that plastic insert or is entirely plastic, it doesn't require bonding. But as always, we want to hear from you. Are you convinced that this pipe in my kitchen doesn't need bonding? Or if you were in my place, would you bond it anyway? I must be honest, because of when I did my training, it will take every ounce of rational thought I possess to stop me from reconnecting that clamp to the pipe. But whatever the case, please leave your thoughts and questions in the comments section below. And as always, thank you very much for watching.